Welcome to Soul Church. If I can ask you to please stand. We're happy to see every single one of you here with us today worshiping God. And as a good tradition at Soul Church, I would like us all, if we can get a little bit more lighting into the sanctuary, please. Just turn to your left and turn to your right. Shake your hand and say, God loves you. Choir, let's go. Show them how it's done. God loves you. There we go. It's a great opportunity for some of the boys to say, God loves you and I love you too. I kind of, you know, yeah, sure, thank you. God. Yes, amen. Awesome. We have an amazing service prepared for us by the Holy Spirit tonight. But in order for us to hear the message, in order for our hearts to be open before God, we need to prepare our hearts. David, in one of his psalms, he said, my heart is ready. So this is the time of worship and the time of prayer right now to prepare our hearts. So I invite every single one of you to a prayer of maybe repentance before God, a prayer of worship, and a prayer for Holy Spirit to work in our hearts and to prepare our hearts to hear His word. So that word would not be in vain. Let's pray. Father God, we are thankful that you are our Lord. We're thankful that you loved us so much that you gave your only Son. You gave the best for us, Lord. We're thankful to you, Jesus Christ, that you willingly came. You bled, you suffered, and you died to take the punishment for our sins. But you did not stay in the grave. You are alive, Lord, and we're here gathered together as your children, Lord, to worship you, to praise you, because only you are worthy of praise. Only you are worthy to glory, Lord. And I'm asking for us tonight, Lord, you see our hearts. Lord, I'm asking for every single one of us that came here with a heavy heart. Lord, please, send hope in our heart. I'm asking for those who came to your house tonight who don't know you personally as their personal Savior. Lord, please prepare their heart. Speak your word into their heart. Lord, we are your children. Soul Church is your church. Everything we do, everything who we are yours. Lord, take us and use us for your glory. I pray this in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Thank you. church, before we sing together again, can we pray? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you place. Thank you, Lord, that we get to worship your name, the name above all other names. Thank you that you are worthy of our worship. We glorify your name. We praise your name. And we ask that you would bless this service. Bless the word that's spoken. Bless our voices as we sing. We're grateful, God. You are Yahweh. You are Emmanuel, Alpha and Omega. And we choose to pray. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for your almighty power. We thank you that we can stand in your presence. Even at an evening service, we can gather and we can worship you. As one body, as traveling people, as those that are local, and we can worship you. And we thank you, Lord, that you're alive and well, that you're working in the midst of every single one of us. I thank you for those that are serving in this church, for their leadership, for every person that is serving in their departments, because this church is breathed by you. It is planted, and it is a church that represents the body of Christ, the bride. And we thank you for what you're doing through Soul Church. We thank you for every person that is able to come and worship you and find refuge in your presence. We love you, we honor you, and in your name we pray. Amen. Amen, amen, church. You guys can be seated. Thank you for joining us this evening. If you are traveling with us, if you're a local Sacramento local native and you're traveling with us, as this is not your first service, thank you for coming. Thank you for not letting it be repetitive for you, but for joining us on these services. And if this is your first time hearing us or seeing us, my name is Eli Zushma, and I'm one of the administrators of the program, and it's a privilege and honor for us to be able to travel 2,740, maybe 8 miles, to be here. The students that are sitting behind me enjoyed the drive. Yeah, see, everyone is smiling. They're singing, their heart is rejoicing, so they definitely are enjoying this. And it's a big privilege for us to be here. Today, we're going to be a part of this service and this program, and it means a lot. So thank you, church, for opening up your doors and the service for us. Thank you guys for coming out at this evening service. We're going to have a program that's going to include more information about our school. You guys will hear testimonies. There's going to be a video that's going to share a little bit about our program. You guys will hear the message from our local Living Stream Church, Pastor Bogdan Bondarenko, that is also traveling with us. And most of all, we want to stay after service and get to know you. You guys have a beautiful lobby, a beautiful outdoor patio area. We want to connect with you because we travel to build relationship and to be in fellowship. That's what Christ wants with us and one another. That's why we're here, to share his love, his goodness, to remind you guys that God is alive in Jacksonville, in Sacramento, and through all the nations. And he's alive in the next generation, which is going to be taking over the churches as we young people, or older people, get older and someone will have to take over. I'd like to welcome Daniel Varzari, that will share what the Lord has already been doing and cultivating him while he is in the Bible school program and what even brought him here to SMBS. Thank you.
Hello, church. It is an absolute privilege to be here with you, to share the living testimony of God that God has placed in my life. And it's also a beautiful thing to see that you are recognized in your community. I was walking through that park, and just to see how many people were talking about this church, it was a beautiful thing. And it's a privilege, especially over this class, to be sharing my testimony, because every single person has been impacted and has been touched by God in this season of their life. So for me in particular, my life can be summarized as seeds planted amongst thistles. And that comes from the parable we know of the sower. And you know, life can choke out that life that God provides us, that truth that God provides us, when we are carried up by the worries and the temptations of this life. You see, when I was a child, I was deep in prayer, even in elementary school when I would play soccer. If someone was to fall down, even if I was going to score a goal, I would go over and I would pray for that person because it was that important. That person was hurt. They needed prayer. In middle school, I would stay up late into the night listening to Billy Graham, reading Revelation, and having all of those truths be over my life. I wanted to be a preacher. I wanted to be a soul winner for God. I wanted to be completely submitted to him in my life. But then high school hit and the worries started to come in, the doubts and the temptations, questions I couldn't answer, questions I couldn't bring to my parents. And I was building for myself a yoke that I couldn't carry. And quickly, those thorns and those thistles began to choke out the faith that began so fresh. And I was avoiding that ultimate question. Jesus knows you. Or sorry, you know about Jesus. You've been in church long enough, but does Jesus know you? Do you truly have love for your God? And so to get through that void, the unfulfilled relationships in my life, I turned to video games, work, pornography, anything that didn't remind me of who I was. I could speak, but I couldn't preach. I could sing, but I couldn't praise. And my life was quickly slipping away from my fingers. And I spent 7 years in a cycle of doubt, self-pity, and in a cycle of condemnation for which I felt God had no answer to. I was in a darkness of my own making, but then I went to church. And it was just a simple prayer night, like any other. And then God placed on my heart that passage from Ephesians, which says that that which is made visible is light. In the darkness that you sit in now, the God of unapproachable light will come in. And just as he reached out to heal and touch the leper, he will heal you as well. And I exited that dungeon that I've spent 7 years in with a fiery passion for God. And because God is so faithful, just a week later, I was at my sister's graduation for SMBS. And there was a raffle. I didn't know it was a raffle. I thought it was a Bible quiz, so I wasn't going to submit anything into it because I knew I wouldn't win. But my dad said to do it. So out of obedience, I filled out it. And my name was called for the scholarship. And even then, I had worries. I had doubts, which I approached my pastor with. You know, it's random. It doesn't really matter. And he told me to not give to the world that which is God's. And that's also true for the eternity which God has placed in our hearts. Don't give to the world that which God has instilled in you. The Spirit, the Word, the truth of his Word is living in you. And that has become especially evident in my time throughout SMBS, because SMBS is a period of fasting from the world, to behold him, to behold the fact that he loved us first, that he called us first, that we don't have anything great in ourselves to offer, and we stand in our worship in that understanding that we worship him because he is great, not because of ourselves. And so, as I was fasting throughout SMBS, I turned my every hunger to him, to not give the world my hunger, but to give my hunger towards God, to give my every desire to him. And you see, I also entered SMBS with doubts because I preached in those 7 years with no conviction. And I was afraid that I couldn't hear the voice of God. But you see, it became evident to me that the voice of God is not just this booming voice, but that our soul is alive. See, our soul isn't something that's locked away or hidden until Judgment Day. Our soul is alive, and it is well. It is breathing in the church according to the Holy Spirit, which rests in us. It is present in our every action, and that became evident to me throughout outreach, just serving children, vacuuming every single thing that I was doing throughout SMBS. God was simply blessing me in it, and I knew he was alive. You see, every single person here is going to have a mission, and it is purposed by God. They don't know exactly what's going to happen because they have placed it in God's hands. And the same is true for you, to place your life in God's hands, because that door is not your limitation. God is calling us to preach to the nations. God is calling us to build families. God is calling us to live according to his word. You too have a living testimony. And if I learned anything from God in this season, it's to take a hold of that precious gift, to seek him first, and he will be faithful.
Gloria to God. Good evening, everyone. It's such a blessing to be here, and I have the privilege of sharing my experience with SMBS. My name is Eliana Zborovska. I'm from Tampa, Florida, and I just want to share with you all how the Lord has been moving in my life and how he's been, what he's been teaching me and everything he's been showing. So for me, SMBS has been an amazing experience, and it has been a platform for the Lord to teach me so many things and to work in my heart and in my mind. And I would say one of the biggest things that SMBS has done for me is it has grown my love for the Word of God, and it has given me so much foundational truths and so many scriptures that I can keep in my heart, and then I can learn deeper and deeper in, with every lesson and every class. And that's just something that the Lord has shown me. It's like the song we were singing, that his word has become more precious than silver. And every day we get to come into a classroom and we get to learn more about his word. We get to learn more about who God is. And it's something that we could have heard our whole lives, some information that we have known in our heads from Sunday school, from every day at church that we would go to church. But the Lord has done this work in my heart where he has taken all of his word that he has taught me throughout my life, and instead of just knowing the word, he has allowed me to live it and allowed me to understand the truth and experience it in a whole new way. And one of the biggest things for me is that I've always had a struggle with if I would ever mess up or if I would ever do something wrong. It would be very hard for me to come to the Lord in that, and it would be very hard for me to receive his grace and understand his love for me, and that his love is unconditional and it doesn't have to do with my works or with what I can do for him, but it's just about who he is, that he is the Lord and I am his daughter. And that's something that the Lord really was able to show me in such a strong way. And he has also given me so much strength in my life, and he has given me steadfastness to where if anything is like going on around me, or if I have struggles or battles, he has given me that foundation and that rock to stand on, so that much less like wavering in my life, where through battles, like the Lord has just given me so much strength. And I would say one of the biggest highlights, something that has helped me grow so much in SMBS, is also just the community and prayers that we would have and worships that we would have. The Lord has taught me so much about functioning in the body of Christ and how each one of us individually is so important, and that each one of us is his child and he loves each of us. And there are so many unique things that he has placed in each of his children that we are able to, in community, we are able to learn more about God through his people as well. And that's just something that I've been learning. And something that has also grown so much in SMBS is a desire for missions, and is a desire to preach the gospel and to share his truth with everyone that you encounter. And this summer, me and my team, we're going to Guatemala. And I'm so excited to go there because, yeah. In Guatemala, we're going to be building churches, we're going to be evangelizing, we're going to be sharing the love of God to everyone we encounter in mountain villages. We're just going to be serving, and we're just going to be taking everything that we learned from the Lord in this season and just sharing it with people who don't know him or have a false view of the Lord. And I'm so excited for this. And I just want to leave you with one thing, and I just something that I would encourage for each one of you is that that step of devotion to the Lord is so special, because once you take a step to devoting a season of life to the Lord, you begin to fall in love with the journey, and you begin to love every day and taking every day slowly with the Lord without any worry, without any stress. And it's so beautiful. Living for him is so fulfilling and so freeing. And I want to encourage you all, if you have the opportunity, to take a step and to take a step of devotion to the Lord and see what he has in store for you. Thank you.
Если я расстаюсь.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Alex Misikovitz. I'm the Dean of Programs here at SMBS Ministries. And first, I just wanted to thank you for allowing us to be here tonight in your evening service with such a full sanctuary as this. It's so exciting to be able to worship with you guys. I just want to take a few minutes to share a little bit more about our program and who we are. SMBS Ministries is turning 20 years old next year, which is really incredible. And we only can accomplish what we accomplish with every one of you guys and all the supporters out there who love and care for this ministry. SMBS Ministries has essentially four parts: SMBS, TBS or Teens Bible School, IDT, and missions. Here in a few weeks after this graduating class, we will begin our TBS program. This is Teens Bible School. It's for students ages 14 to 17, where they come to Jacksonville for 4 weeks. It's not a summer camp. During this time, what they do is they learn biblical knowledge during the first half of their day. They sit in classes. They learn from a teacher who teaches them about the life of Jesus, about what the Bible is, about what truth is. And then the second half of their day is filled with fun activities to ignite their passion to live after the Lord. This includes driving and learning how to drive manual, which is pretty forgotten nowadays. They learn to cook. They learn woodworking. So it's filled with activities. And the purpose behind this program is to really just get teenagers passionate about following the Lord. I think growing up, maybe many of us, like myself, have believed just following the Lord is not the fun thing, quote unquote, to do. Yet it's the best life that they can live. And we want teenagers leaving knowing, wow, following Jesus is amazing. And it's the greatest thing that I could do for my life. And so they spend 4 weeks with us during the summer learning all about that. A couple months after that begins our fall program, which is IDT, or Intensive Discipleship Training. This class is a smaller class size of about 32 to 36 students, and it's for students who are coming in ready to become disciple makers. Jesus gave the Great Commission at the end of his life saying, go and make disciples of all nations. So students coming into this program first learn what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. They sit in classes, they take the practical steps, they fast, they pray. But then the second half of the program is focused on training them to be disciple makers. With such a small class size, each one of them is paired with a mentor that they walk with once a week that holds them accountable, walks through life with them. And then for the second half, they actually choose someone from back home to begin mentoring and walking with so that they can get trained for when they come home to make disciples around them. Our third program is the beautiful faces that you see right behind me. It is our Slavic Missionary Bible School. These students have already been in class for three months of preparation. It's about 75 to 82 students that come in, and their whole point is to first build a biblical foundation upon the Lord and what Scripture teaches. But there's also a missionary focus. They're trained for missions. They're put into missionary teams, preparing them to go on missionary trips after the program. In addition to that, their 5 months that they spend at SMBS, they're trained practically in outreach programs. They have accountability as well, where they're required to read Scripture, have time with the Lord, and pray. And all of this is to prepare most of them who would be going on missions after SMBS. We have 10 teams that are going out this year in the summer to preach the gospel across the globe. Those 10 teams are Poland, Nepal, Burma, Sri Lanka, Japan, Kenya, Tanzania, Colombia, Guatemala, and because our country needs the gospel message as well, we have a team going to Alabama as well for missions, which is pretty incredible. Thank you. Yes. It's exciting. They're excited. For many of them, it's their first time going on mission. So they're preparing themselves, getting ready to go out. And they need your prayers. In the back, we have an info table set up. You can find all of their cards with their faces like you saw on the screen up there. And really, they might be facing a physical battle. They might get hungry sometimes. But more importantly, they're facing a spiritual battle. And so they need your prayers. Please grab a card, put it on your refrigerator, put it wherever you walk by the most so that you can keep them in your prayers anytime that you see it. For most of them, they'll be going for about a month long, but for some of them, they end up buying a one-way ticket, staying for three, six, 3 to 6 months, a year, end up staying however long they feel like the Lord's leading them to go and preach the gospel. But one thing we know is true. The gospel will be preached no matter what. There's places that are dark and broken that need the good news. And we just get to partner with God in preaching the gospel. Whether it be here in our hometown or across the seas in a different country, people need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. And we get to just be a part of that. Now, I'm sure there's opportunities for you to go locally to mission trips with your church or different organizations. But if you are interested in coming with us, please feel free to stop by the info desk. We invite you to come with us on missions, join a missionary team, go to a different country. But either way, I just encourage you to recognize that we are all missionaries. We're all called to carry this good news and bring it to places that need it. Just to get a few more minutes of your attention, if you would turn your attention to the screen, you'll see a little bit more about our individual programs and what SMBS stands for. Thank you.
The whole creation is yearning, groaning for children of God to rise.
In 2004, God put it on my heart to take a step of faith and open a missionary school. From the beginning, the vision was to equip students with biblical truth, train them, and send missionaries across the world. Fast forward to today, God has used SMBS to transform lives and send many people to the missions field and start their own ministries.
SMBS is a full-time, six-month-long program for students from different states, countries, and ages. Part of our vision is to teach students biblical truths through new topics and teachers weekly and classes every day.
Working with young adults, we noticed a real need for teens ministry among Slavic churches. So in 2011, we acted on the need, and we were amazed to see the response from teenagers and parents all across the states.
So many teenagers growing up, grow up, hear about God from their parents, they learn about God, but I believe TBS is a time where they can actually come and meet God for themselves, like encounter God for themselves.
Over several years, we saw the need in churches for leaders trained in disciple making and mentoring. The vision of IDT is to equip adults of any age to first be disciples of Jesus, but to also be disciple makers.
He's gonna spark a fire inside every heart so that the church will be a blazing pillar.
We believe that God wants to partner with His children, that He wants to use our hands and our feet to do the things that His heart beats for. And when He says go, we want to go. Go to our cities, to our country, and to the nations, preaching the good news of the one who sent us.
Откроем сердца, ждем встречи с тобою, Господь наш Царь. Откроем врата, откроем сердца, ждем встречи с тобою, о Господь наш Царь. Мы стоим на пороге. славы, каждый взор устремлен на тебя. Бьется сердце страстно, приближая к тебе каждый шаг.
One, two, three, these mics. Thank you so much. Let's give a round of applause for our friends. Thank you and all glory to God. Amen. Thank you so much. Again, wow, it's a big crowd tonight. Is there anybody who's first time at Soul? Please raise your hand if it's your first time at Soul Church. Soul Church, let's welcome those who are the first time here. Let's also welcome our foyer. Thank you for so much for those who are in the foyer. And also, can we give a big round of applause? Thank you for those who are in our coffee shop. Welcome. We're happy to be with all of you guys. And thank you for joining us today for the service. If nobody told you today that they love you, we will not be the first one to tell you that we love you here. Thank you so much for coming. But we want to tell you more. We love you, but Jesus loves you even more. If you are in the high moment of your life right now, or if you're in the low moment of your life, if you think you don't deserve to be here, you don't deserve God's love, I just want to share good news with you to say that God loves you. Amen. We have just a few announcements. Thank you so much again for visiting Soul Church tonight. This announcement is not for you if it's your first time. However, if you've been coming to church, we have a special thing called giving. So this is a ministry where we gather the finances together to support the local church, support the local missions that we do. We have a lot of missionary work that we do all over the world, especially in Ukraine, during the war right now. So if it's on your heart to give to the Lord, you can do it three ways. First way, you can give it in the buckets. Second, you can do it through our Soul Church app, in which you can find all the information, all of the things that we do here at Soul Church. And third, you can do it directly online. We welcome you. Please feel free in the way you do it. Also, we have prepared a lounge for you guys. And besides the choir that is going to be fed, we prepared a food for you. Not only spiritual food, but also food for our stomach. So we encourage you, every single one of you, especially youth, to stay after church. Don't rush to go home. There's food for you. There's coffee for you. Only if you're up to like 27, it's okay to drink coffee at like 7 p.m. If you're like my age, or some of our pastor's age, it's not safe for you to drink coffee at 7 p.m. So, but if you're youth, and we have the best coffee in Sacramento, Station Coffee, it's our church members, they roast coffee themselves. So we're welcoming you to try our Soul Church coffee and stay for a soul lounge to have fellowship with the choir. If you have any questions about school, they have the tables there. Please come, because this is not just the work of the church in Jacksonville. This is the work of the kingdom of God. And we are doing this together by prayer, by supporting financially, and by helping out the students. And now, I would like to welcome a person who's going to preach tonight. That person, this person, is our brother, especially for the Ukrainian community. After the war started, he became an encouragement and a blessing for Ukrainian people. Я хочу запросити людину, яка під час повномасштабної війни, яка почалась 2 роки назад, для дуже багатьох українців він став багатою і дуже доброю підтримкою. Тому я хочу запросити сюди нашого друга, брата і пастора Богдана Бондаренка. Будь ласка. God bless you, brother.
It's a privilege to be with you guys tonight. I heard a lot about your church. I met your pastor, Vadim, and I love his open, generous, and simple heart. And I can definitely tell my first impression that your church is very hospitable. Your church is very unique. And there is a lot of action that is happening in this small building. My name is Bogdan. I come from Jacksonville, Florida, from Living Stream Church. And I am surprised. I met so many familiar faces. I met so many people that I didn't even expect that I'm going to meet here. So it's a joy to be with you guys tonight. And I am honored to share a message. By the way, I am married. I have 3 kids and 1 wife. And yeah, the topic of my message today is how to stop worrying. I learned that people in Sacramento, they worry a lot. And I'm excited to remind all the believers that the Word of God addresses the issue of worry, stress, and anxiety. I know that worry has the reason why people worry could be physical or spiritual. Sometimes people deal with anxiety or worry because they have lack of, for example, potentially it's the chemical disbalance in their physical body. But many of our problems, they have a spiritual root. And one of the reasons why people constantly, chronically worry is because they never discovered God's peace. They don't know God. They don't know what God or His Word has to say about worry. So today I would like to share this message of peace, especially if you are stressed, if you are constantly, if you live in anxiety. And worry has two sides. One side, it's a good one. It's when you worry because you are, it's a sign of responsibility. You are a good father. You want to provide for your family and you care about your family. So that's the good side. The bad side is when you constantly live in fear, when you chronically stressed, when you live in fear, when you deal with insomnia, when you don't know or when you don't trust God. And the problem of anxiety or worry, from my observations, it's getting worse and worse. This problem is progressing. Worry and anxiety overwhelms the world today. People from different age groups, they deal with worry and anxiety. And I don't have time today to share some statistics, what happens in this country. However, one thing that shocks me is that worry, it's an issue not only among adults, but also among teenagers. And I wonder why our kids, our teens, why do they have to suffer from anxiety? And one of the reasons that I found is because our society today is rejecting God. Our society today is intentionally denying God. They don't want to live by godly principles. They refuse to honor the Word of God. And every time when a society rejects God, people drown in anxiety. And I'm sure every person experienced stress or worry, just like every person experienced the flu or a fever. But the key is not to get stuck in that condition. Otherwise, it's destructive to your physical body and it's destructive to your spirit as well. So let's dive together into the Word of God, and we're going to read from Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 through 9. The Bible says, you can follow on the screen, do not be anxious about anything. Let's pause right there. Anything includes your future, your present, material, and spiritual. Do not be anxious. Other translation says, do not worry about anything. Right away, it seems too fanatic. It seems irrational. It seems impossible. The Word of God is addressing believers, those who know who Jesus Christ is. And in order for us, if we want to benefit from this passage, from the Word of God, the Bible says in Hebrews 4 that if we heard the Word of God, but we did not mix it with faith, it doesn't bring us much good. So everything you're going to hear tonight, it's not enough just to agree with this information. It's not enough. You might like this sermon, but if you don't mix it with faith, it might not benefit you personally. So do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, pay attention, it's not just regular peace. It's not an earthly peace that depends on circumstances, depends on economics, depends on your health. It's the peace of God that does not depend on circumstances. It's a supernatural peace that only believers have access to that peace. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. It's irrational. It's not logical. It's that supernatural peace that we as believers can have. Will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Verse 8, it says, finally, brothers and sisters. It's like a conclusion. Finally. So what is it all about? Finally. Think about these things. No, let's go back to the verse. Let's go back to the, yeah. Thinks about these things. And then it says, whatever is true, whatever is pure. The Bible gives us a list of things that we are supposed to think about. Which means that there are other things that we should not think about. That we should not focus about. Because your mind, it's a battleground. So that's why it's important to remember. The scripture calls us to renew our mind and to filter your thoughts. And here it says what we're supposed to think about. And then verse 9, it says, what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things. Practice these things. Why do you have to practice? Because some people, they might look for the best doctor in Sacramento. You might find a doctor who has the highest rating, and this doctor gives you instructions what you're supposed to do if you want to get better. But if you don't follow the instructions, if you don't practice, if you don't obey, it's not going to benefit you. You might look for a different doctor, but will it help you? Until you actually obey and do what he says. That's why here in this passage it says, make sure to practice these things that we just read. It will help you to have peace. It will help you to stop worrying only if you actually practice. Practice if you train yourself, if you accept that biblical method. I'm sure you have tried many methods how to calm yourself down, how to try to obtain that peace. And here's another method that I'm trying to present to you. It's a biblical method that will help you to stop worrying. In this passage, we will see four practical steps. I'm sure many people, they know that worry and stress and anxiety, it's not good for you. But there is no button that you can press that will help you to stop worrying. Sometimes you press it and it doesn't work. This button does not exist. And I'm very happy that the Word of God, it's very practical. It doesn't just give you knowledge or another piece of information. But when you apply that Word of God, it brings you more than information. It brings you transformation. I believe we have enough information in this society and we want transformation. So on the next slide, I want you to see four steps out of this passage. Now, if we can go back to the slide where we see yes, thank you. So you see, that same passage, I'm giving you a summary where you will see four practical steps what to do if you want to worry less. Step number one, it says, do not be anxious about anything but. Other translations, it says, instead. You cannot just stop worrying. You can only replace worry with something else. Do not worry, do not be anxious, but. And here we go. Practical step number one, by prayer. Step number two, with thanksgiving. Now let's go back. Step number three, it says, think about these things. And number four, practice. Practice. And the God of peace will be with you. So on the next slide, you can see four steps that you can take and meditate and apply it into your life according to the scripture. It's not just philosophical ideas. It's not just my ideas. It's not a trick where you just think positively. You just be positive. It's straight from the Word of God. It's biblical method that I believe can help any believer if you believe. So how to stop worrying? Number one, pray to God. Number two, thank God. Number three, filter or redirect your thoughts. And number four, practice. Make sure to practice. Make sure to apply these things in your life. Today we will have time to only go through first two points. So let's go into point number one. What does it mean to pray? Pray to God. Philippians 4 verse 6, it says, in everything by prayer and supplication. Do not be anxious, but come to God in prayer and supplication. It's interesting that it says prayer and supplication. Supplication, in other words, it's a petition or a request. For us, request or it's part of prayer. We have the right to come to God and ask Him for something. However, if you read the New Testament, you will see that in multiple passages, in different passages, you will see that prayer and supplication, somehow it's separated, it's highlighted. Prayer and supplication. Why? What is prayer? Prayer, it's a tool that we as people are given where we can have fellowship with God. Through Jesus Christ, our fellowship with God was restored. I don't have time to quote you the scriptures where it says that we can have fellowship with God. Fellowship can have different levels. I'm sure you have friends that you invite over or you visit and you enjoy fellowship with them just because. You can talk about any topic. You don't have an agenda. You don't need anything from them. You just enjoy their company. You fellowship with them and you enjoy their presence. But you have other friends that call you and you know they call you not because they want to ask you how are you doing. They call you every time because they need something from you. And every time they come to you, they always come to you with a petition, with a supplication. And you know those people, right? You don't spend time with them in fellowship. It's just business talk, you know, like, I need this, this, and that, and I need your help. So if you would ask yourself, when I come to God, do I come to Him with prayer and supplication? Or do I come to God just with supplication. I come to God only when I'm in trouble. I come to God only when I have an issue. I come to God only when I have problems. And praise God for His mercy. We have the right to come and ask Him. The Bible says, ask and you will receive. But don't skip that first step. It says prayer and supplication. Prayer is simply a fellowship where you come to God not only because you need something from God. You come to Him because you love Him. One of the first commandments, it says, love your God and love your neighbor. So when you love your God, when you truly love your God, you will come to God because you enjoy His presence, because you enjoy your time of fellowship with Him. You come to Him not just because you need something from Him. And as you fellowship with Him, of course, sometimes you present your needs and your requests to Him. That's part of your relationship with God. As we can see, the Bible says, do not be anxious, but come in prayer. That simply means that prayerless heart or prayerless life breeds an anxious mind. If you don't have that habit, if it's not part of your routine or standard lifestyle, either in the morning or in the evening or both, when you come to God constantly on a regular basis in prayer because you know that you need Him, you depend on Him, and you enjoy that time with Him, it brings you peace, comfort. That's why you come to God with prayer and supplications. It's interesting that the scripture says when we come and we ask God, some passages they say that our Heavenly Father, He knows our needs before we even ask Him. So my question is, why do we have to come to God with prayer if He knows our needs? Why should we pray if He already knows? And I will give you an example. Why? I have three children. And my youngest daughter, when she was about five, I remember we received an Amazon package. And she was so excited, so she grabbed the package and she ran into the house and she wanted to open the package. Me as a father, right away, I knew that she won't be able to open that package. I knew she doesn't have the necessary tools. She doesn't have the knowledge or doesn't have enough strength to even open that big package. And when I tried to offer her help, she said, no, Daddy, I got it. I will open the package by myself. And when you look at your 4 or 5 year old child who is like struggling, suffering, trying to open the package, you know that she won't be able to open the package on her own. But she gives me that look. Don't even interrupt. Don't get involved. I got it. I will open the package. And you're like, okay, here we go. Let's just, I know it's a waste of time, but you know, she thinks she got it. And after some time, after she was struggling, she started looking my way. She didn't ask for help yet. She just started looking my way. And then finally, she said, okay, Daddy, can you please help me to open the package? I knew about her need since the beginning. But she needed time to realize that she needs help from her father. When we come to God with our requests and supplications, We pray to him not because God did not know, he knew. But when we come to him, it's a sign of, now I admit my weakness. I admit that I am in need of your help. I admit that I am dependent from God. And that's exactly what God is waiting for. What we as people often, we try our own, we have our connections, we have our experience, we have many other things. And as a last resort, we have been going through so much stress, worry, anxiety, and then finally we come to God, Lord, now rescue me, help me. But that's the first thing we should have done. That's why the Bible says, do not worry, do not be anxious, but the first step, come to me in prayer. So the first step, practical thing you can do if you want to worry less, is come to God in prayer with supplications on a regular basis. Step number two is thank God. Thank God. It's interesting. Yeah, if we can go to the next slide. Thank God. Step number two. And now let's read one more time. Philippians 4:6. It says, come to God with thanksgiving. With, next slide, with thanksgiving. It's interesting that gratitude and peace are very connected. And I will show it to you through several passages from the scripture. Thanksgiving or gratitude must be the DNA of every mature believer. It's probably easy to thank God when you have received something from God, when you are healthy, when you're doing good. The Bible says be thankful at all time. However, when you go through trials, when you are in pain, when you are struggling, when you don't understand everything, and in that season, when you come to God with thanksgiving, I think that has a very special value in God's eyes. Because that means that you, through your thanksgiving, even though you are in pain, you express your faith. That's how you confess that you choose to still trust God. You still choose Him as your first source of help. You rely on Him. That's why you come to Him with thanksgiving. First Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 16, it says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you. This is God's will for us as believers. Obviously, when you read those passages, it seems very, very spiritual, very irrational. It seems impossible to apply. I am sure you would agree that it's hard to rejoice always. It's hard to be thankful for everything that we have in our lives. And that's where I would like to show you the context of the book of Philippians. The context. You remember we read from Philippians chapter 4. And I will give you a quick summary. The context that believers were living in when that book was sent to them. So chapter 1, Paul, he says that we are called not only to believe in him, but also to suffer. We're called not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake. That's chapter 1. Then another point is that Paul, he writes this letter from the prison. So I'm sure he was in pain. I'm sure he was troubled. I'm sure the future was unknown. And in the midst of his suffering, he's writing this epistle to the believers. And he's saying, rejoice always. Be thankful for everything. It seems irrational. But Paul, somehow, he found that source of peace in the midst of his trials. Then chapter 3, it says, your citizenship is in heaven. why he brings up this point of citizenship. Because he wants to remind the believers that we should look at life from the perspective of eternity. We should look at our problems through the prism of eternity. And once we learn how to do that, we will have a different view, a different stand, a different feel about our problems. Because we have learned, we understood that our life here on earth is temporary. Your problems will end for sure. It will end. And we must always remember that our focus, our goal as believers is eternity. That's why he reminds them and he's trying to teach them that we should look at life from the perspective of eternity, which means that the context of this book refers to living in another dimension. And in that context, he's writing, do not be anxious about anything. So when you hear those words, you might say to yourself, well, you know, if you only knew my problems, if you only knew what I'm dealing with. Yes, it's true, maybe I don't know. And I don't want to just sound smart because I did not experience everything that potentially you have experienced. I don't mean to put you down, that you're stressed, but I'm here to bring you the message of hope. I'm here to share the gospel. I believe that the Word of God is addressing this issue of stress and anxiety and worry. And this word was written for all age groups, for different circumstances, for different life situations. And the Bible says, do not worry. And if we can only grab and we can accept that word by faith, we can have access to that supernatural peace. People back then, they did not have banks, hospitals, or social help. Infrastructure did not exist. People were persecuted and killed for their faith. And in that context, Paul is writing, rejoice always. Do not be anxious about anything. You can have access to supernatural peace that surpasses your understanding. And when the Bible says rejoice, you rejoice not because you have problems. You have a problem and you rejoice. You don't rejoice because of problems, because you're mentally unstable. You rejoice because of your faith. You delight in your faith because you have this revelation from God, from the Word of God, that God can grant us this peace, that supernatural peace. You understood that our life on earth is temporary. Our future is eternity. And our journey here on earth, it's just a process that prepares us for this eternity. And once you understood, you look at life from a different perspective. And that's why you rejoice always, because you know something that other people don't know. Because you know the Word of God that brings you peace. Because you know Jesus who said, I am your peace. And you have access to that peace. That's why you rejoice. And then it says, because this is God's will. This is God's will for you, for us as believers. Colossians 3:15, it says, and let the peace of God, once again, you see, it's not just peace. It says the peace of God. Often it says God's peace. It's not just an ordinary peace. It's a special godly peace. May the peace of God rule in your hearts. As believers, we should not just experience peace when we're in a good mood. It says, may the peace of God rule in your hearts and in your mind. So that means that we should be ruled not by emotions, not by provocations, not by circumstances, but we should be ruled by the peace of God.
Every time you make a decision, every time you want to react to something, every time you have a plan, you're dealing with an issue, remember that we as believers, we're called, the Bible says we're called. It's not just a wish. If you are in a good mood, if you would like to choose, it says you as a believer, you are called. It's a standard criteria for every Christian. We are called to be ruled by the peace of God. And you might say, well, I like it. I like this idea. I kind of agree with you. I just have one question. How? How? I don't mind to have more peace. I would love for this peace to rule in my family. The question is how? I'm glad you asked, because the Word of God gives us that answer. In that same passage, you can see the answer. So how? At the end of this verse, it says, and be thankful. NLT translation says, and always be thankful. Do you see how gratitude and peace are connected? It comes in the same package. If you want to have peace, you are called to be grateful. It's interesting that you cannot be grateful and angry at the same time. You cannot be thankful and grumble or complain at the same time. Have you ever tried to be thankful to your wife and to complain to her at the same time? Usually it's either or, right? So I want you to see that principle that replaces the bad thing, the negative thing. You cannot just stop worrying. You can only replace it with something else. That's why the Bible says, think about these things. That's why the Bible says, do not worry, but instead do something else. And here we see that same principle one more time, where if you want to have that peace, then replace it. Your worry, your complaints, replace it with thanksgiving. It's like when you turn on the light, it pushes out the darkness. So when you are dealing with worry and anxiety, start thanking God for things that you potentially don't understand, maybe you don't understand. Because that's a practical application of your faith. Let me give you final passage from Romans chapter 4 verse 20. It talks about gratitude and praise, how it impacts your faith. It says, no unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God. It talks about Abraham. But he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God. At that moment, in that context, Abraham did not receive his promise yet. He was dreaming and praying about his son. He wanted to have a child. He did not receive it yet, so while he was going through that season, what did he do? The Bible says he gave glory to God. And it's interesting, it says he grew strong in faith. How? While he was struggling, while he was going through trials, how? He remained firm in his faith. He gave glory to God. Question, what for? He did not receive his promise yet. His prayers were not answered yet, and he still gave glory to God. And this is
a big conclusion. If you don't have a reason to be grateful to God, then go to the next level of relationship with God and start praising God. If you don't have a reason what to be grateful for to God, then go to the next level and start praising God. And if we can have that quote on the screen, we praise God not for what we received, we praise God for who He is. For us, He is Lord, He is God who controls the universe. He's still on the throne. So we praise Him. Usually we say thank you to someone when we received something. It's interesting that Abraham, he did not thank God, he praised God. If we can go back to that verse that we just read, I want you to see Romans. He did not thank God, he gave glory to God. And let me give you one more passage, Job chapter 1. So it was hard for Job, you know, to thank God because he did not receive something from God. He experienced only loss after loss, only losses. His business was taken, his health was destroyed, and he buried his children. After these horrible news, this is what Job does. The Bible says he fell to the ground to worship. I want you to see that Job did not thank God. He worshiped God. Do you see that next level? Sometimes we struggle with, what do I thank God for? My house was destroyed. My family members maybe passed away from a sickness. My child is disabled. What am I supposed to be grateful for? So remember, you thank God not for what you have received, but for who He is. And He is our God. So if you are going through a problem today, if you're struggling, if you deal with anxiety, if you deal with fear, if you're troubled, if you don't have that peace, I would like to invite you, if we can have these 4 points on the screen one more time, to apply those practical steps in your life. You can read Philippians chapter 4 this upcoming week and meditate on it. And the Bible says practice it. We only had time to discuss just first 2 steps. There's 2 more. Ask Holy Spirit, please help me to understand. Help me to apply it into my personal life. I want and I need that peace that surpasses all understanding. I want that peace in my life today. Lord, I admit that I am dependent on You. I need You. Amen. Let's stand together, church. I would like to pray. We will pray together, and then after, when we transition to another song, if you are here tonight and if you would like to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, maybe for the first time, maybe you realize that you tried to fix your life on your own, but you were unable to do. Today you can come to Jesus and tell Him, Lord, Jesus Christ, I believe in you. I choose you as my personal Lord and Savior. And I want to ask for forgiveness of my sins. I want to surrender to you, and I want to admit that I need you, God, in my life. When we will be singing, you can come forward right in front of this stage, and pastors and ministers will pray for you. If you are already saved, if you are already a believer, but you are dealing with anxiety, worry, stress, if you don't have that peace, you can also come, and pastors and ministers will be happy to pray for you. If you believe in the Word of God, if you believe that God can help you, I believe once I made the decision to follow my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I have zero regrets. That was the best decision I made in my life. And I challenge and I invite you to make that decision tonight. Let's take a couple minutes to pray right now. If we can all bow our heads and close our eyes. If you don't know how to pray, just speak to God and speak as to your friend and tell him what's on your heart. He can hear you. Heavenly Father, right now I pray for those who are here, who came tonight, who are in this building, and I also pray for people who are watching online, for those who are in need of peace. I pray for people who are suffering from pain, from losses, suffering from questions. They have this chronic stress, and they are so tired, exhausted, overwhelmed with worry. Today, I was just the messenger. Lord, help us to focus on your word. Help many people tonight to accept that challenge, that biblical method, that we don't have to be in prison of anxiety. There is freedom in you, Jesus Christ. There is peace through you, Jesus. I pray for every mother and father. I pray for young people, older people. I pray and I stand, Lord God, before you because I believe in you. Because you are my Lord, you are my God. You are full of love and mercy. You have that compassion. And you extend this invitation. If you believe that I can give you peace, come to me. Come to me, and I will help you to experience that peace that surpasses our understanding. Lord, I want to bless this church and the leadership of this church. I want to bless every single person in this service tonight. Lord, I thank you for that message of hope. I thank you, Lord God, that we can have peace in you and through you. Jesus, help us to practice and apply these things. Amen. As we sing right now, if you would like to receive prayer, the altar is open. You can come forward if you need prayer. And pastors will pray for you personally. If you would like to accept Jesus as your Savior, please let us know about it. And we'll be happy to pray for you as well. As we sing, you can meditate on this message. Think about it.
Чтобы вытереть. поднять душу твою. Ты думал, все выхода нет. Дитя мое, вот мой ответ. Рядом я с тобой всегда. Не покину никогда. Зажигаю я тебя, чтобы славил вновь меня. Защитить тебя, ты не бойся никогда, уповай лишь на меня. Я держу в своих руках, чтобы защитить тебя. Ты не бойся никогда, уповай лишь на меня. Я держу в своих руках, чтобы защитить тебя. Ты не бойся никогда, уповай лишь на меня. Я держу в своих руках, чтобы защитить тебя. Ты не бойся никогда, уповай лишь на меня. Зажигаю я тебя, чтобы славил вновь меня. Рядом я с тобой всегда. Не покину никогда. Зажигаю я тебя, чтобы славил вновь меня.
Since people are still praying, those who came especially forward, let's take another minute or two and pray to our Heavenly Father. Just say thank you, Lord, for everything He has done in your life. Say thank you to God for everything, even though sometimes we don't always understand, but it's our choice. We take that stand to still thank God. Heavenly Father, I thank you once again for this privilege to know you. I thank you, Lord God, for your word that gives us instructions for life. I thank you for your word that gives us hope, that helps us, Lord God, to go through these seasons in our lives. I thank you, Lord God, for all the reminders that you send us through your word. Help us as believers to always remember to look at our life issues and questions through the prism of eternity. Lord, I thank you for this evening. I thank you for this service. I thank you, Lord God, for this fellowship that we had with our brothers and sisters. I ask God, Father, come with your peace. Let every person ask to have that peace in you and through you, Jesus Christ. Lord, we honor you. We thank you. We give you all the glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Church, you may be seated. We will have a couple more announcements.
Once again, thank you so much, Soul Church, for hosting us, for having us. If I'm not mistaken, this is your fifth service. That's incredible what the Lord is doing and allowing this place to stay open from early morning till late at night. Whoever's here all day, they have a truly special anointing. God bless you guys. Our evening is coming to an end, so we want to just end with a few announcements. If I'm not mistaken, there's going to be fellowship and food and coffee for all ages after service, so we invite you to stay and fellowship with us. We are going to continue staying in Sacramento. Our buses are parked. We're not going anywhere. We're just going to continue visiting churches and sharing the same great news and great song and great message. So if you haven't had enough of us, or you know other churches that will be in the area that you see on the screen behind me, stop by, visit us. We would love to get to know you more and more. And on Saturday, we have a special night where we're going to talk more about what the Lord's been doing for, as you heard, the past 19 years at our banquet. It's going to be free food like today, but you're going to have an opportunity to get more word from Pastor Bogdan, more personal conversations. You're going to get to sit at a round table, and the focus is to get more people plugged into what SMBS is doing and it to be possible, like viewers like you. Thank you. I see a lot of young people here today, so I wanted to do something unique and special and give an opportunity to waive an application fee. If you believe that what you heard today through the testimonies or through the singing or the message, and you say, you know what, I want to do that. I want to put aside some time of my life and pursue the Lord. We want to extend our invitation as well and waive an application fee. So out in the hall at the info table, come up and they'll have a code for you to apply to SMBS in January so that you guys can also be a part of that. And we have a tradition to be able to honor the pastor, the house leader. If I can get pastor to come up front, we have something great for you today. It's a message that says, Jesus, ask me about his freedom. He is still the answer. We want this to be something that you wear boldly because you speak boldly. You invite people boldly, even on stage, to share things that they're not ready to share. Like, you know, we love you, and they can't do that quite yet. But you got the power and authority here, so we want to honor you. We want to respect you. And thank you for having us. God bless you. Keep your hands up high for all that you do.
Thank you so much. Хочу звернутися українському. Друзі, ми раді, що ви сьогодні були разом з нами. Якщо Дух Святий сьогодні касався вас, ми маємо молитовний куточок, там будуть сидіти наші служителі. Можете підійти, особисто помолитися. Якщо ні, друзі, я хочу, щоб ми завершили наше спілкування тут молитвою за їжу. Тому, друзі, у нас буде безкоштовна їда, супчик на вечір, сендвіч. It's gonna be great. Дуже буде класно. Тому, друзі, я прошу, ми піднялися. Let's all stand. And let's just finish with prayer. Father God, we're thankful for this day. We're thankful for the words, your words. Lord, I'm praying for us to be the hearers of faith. Those who would walk outside and actually act on what we heard today. So your word would not be in vain today. Please bless us. Give us wisdom. We're thankful for the food, for the fellowship. Amen. Друзі, якщо у вас є бажання підійти до друзів, до пастора Богдана, до нас, ви можете це зробити. Нехай Господь вас благословить. Ми чекаємо вас наступну неділю в церкві Сол. 5 служінь.